Hi, this is Kelly from The Truth in Story, and today is the 26th. Yes, the 26th of January, so we're at 26 days and the 31 days of tarot, and Isabel is wired up. I can't do anything about it. I'm wet, she's wet, she took a bath, and once she takes a bath, then I have to take a bath because I'm coated with wet dog water, and she is now geared up because she hates baths, but she loves being wet. It's a tough life being a puppy. So I'm going to real quick answer a question I've had a viewer ask me, and then I've had actually several people message me about stones, putting stones on top of my decks that are out and which ones I've chosen and why. So I'm going to kind of switch away to hand-holding so I can just show you the ones that I have on my decks that are out, and then I'll be back. Okay, now you guys have all seen these boxes, so I'm not going to really focus on them too much. You can see with my Benabel Wen's Chinese Oracle here, as well as my Tao Oracle and my Osho Zen, I keep large I Ching or I Ching, however you choose to say that, it is I Ching. I've been quite thoroughly schooled in. I keep those on those three there, along with these are my smaller I Ching that I actually use to cast. So I don't keep stones on those decks. But when a deck is out of my collection, so is not in its box, then I always have a stone with it. And so somebody had asked me, you know, how I chose those. Generally, it's just because it feels right. A lot of times it's aesthetically just pleasing. Like this is a beautiful blue obsidian or onyx gorgeousness that's on my Heart of the Fairy. I have this gorgeous, I don't even always know, this is petrified wood that's on my Madame Endor's Fortune card. I have a piece of rough ametrine that is on my Vintage Wiz, I think. I probably would get some of these stone names wrong. I don't even know what this is on my Messenger Oracle. Somebody said maybe serpentine something. That's on there. I have this gorgeous bloodstone? Dragon's blood? Something like that. Dragon's blood, I think. That is on my Gaia because it felt very earthy. I have a piece of rough rose quartz on my Llewellyn. Sometimes it just is because it feels right. I don't really have a whole lot of reason. They're off because I had these down, but on my Druid plant and animal, I have two because it's two decks mixed in. Sodalite, and I'm guessing this may be moss agate here that go on here. I have some just rough stones. Generally the Norman decks I don't keep stones on, but that one just have some rough ones on it. I have this gorgeous Turritella that was sent to me by Miss Kaleidoscope from a Henge area that is an area where Will Worthington draws a lot of his artwork for the Druid craft in Wildwood, and so that's always will be there. For my Wildwood, I don't know what this is, but it had that similar feel just with lighter colors, and I love it, and so it goes on there. And then here I have a rough piece of labradorite that was gifted to me. I love this. Right now that's on my witches. As above deck. I have this particularly. This is generally my main working decks or what I'm working on at the moment. So I have two decks that are kind of right now very main for me, along with these two. Also have decks that I'm working on. Like I'm working on the Earthbound Oracle that has, or the Wooden Tarot that has a shell on it. And I'm just started working with this, so it's out with that. I know it's dark back here. This is my Tarot of the Hidden Realms This is my only single deck that has two stones, and it just, I've tried separating them, but they will not be separated. So that's a piece of Apache Tear and a piece of Smoky Quartz. I have this gorgeous, I don't know what this is, but I adore this stone. And this goes on my Wild Unknown, which is one of my primary decks. And my Quartz, Clear Quartz, goes on my Fountain Tarot. I want to get a bigger piece of Clear Quartz. It's a very strong stone for me. So that goes there. Now let me shift over. Over here I have my Bohemian Gothic, and I have a piece of Black Onyx on it, and this is a piece of, oh, I know what this is, but I can't think of it. This actually came on another deck, don't be mad, Melissa, but it wanted to come onto my, sometimes it's a very strong feeling of what should be on it, and sometimes it's just because, but that, it was gifted to me with another piece, with another deck, but it really likes the Rackham Oracle, so it is there. I have this gorgeous Heart Labradorite, which is one of my favorite stones, that is on, I don't generally keep stones, but on my Isabel Lenormand, that's where that sits. This one actually doesn't have one at the moment, which is kind of interesting. But I use that one a lot, I guess. I'm not sure. I have this gorgeous, actually this, I think this is the rough, yeah. See, I'm so bad. Thankfully, I do have these in videos somewhere. This, I think, is Ametrine. The Ametrine Moon sent me. Maybe that one. See, a lot of times it's color, but then sometimes it's not. It's like, that doesn't quite feel right. So I'll kind of mess around and see if something else pops up and feels right. Usually I don't have any. Ooh, look at this one. That kind of feels good. And I'll just try it out. But then if it doesn't, oops, my finger's there. If it doesn't stay, sometimes I'll just go by and I'm like, no, 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 it's not right. And I'll just keep taking it off. And then I'll know that's just really not the right piece. That's just got miscellaneous stones. My chakra stones are on my rune deck. And then this is my reading table. You've all seen this before, but these are my other. So this is my one of my talismans. And I'm not going to say the name because Patrick's going to laugh at me. It's my favorite. And these are my other talismans. This is my piece of Labradorite. I think Carol sent me that. I hate to say it because I don't know if I'm wrong. And then this, I have them all written down. I really do. And this is my piece, or my Clear Quartz Pendulum, and a gorgeous piece of Shungite, which I purchased. That is, so these four things are pretty much what I consider my talismans. I have a big piece of amethyst points, and then this is the crystal grid that I'm working with right now. I have this little piece of birch that I keep mini grids on for my table, and this has my piece of rose quartz in the middle, has amethysts, and then it has these little garnets that I found. I look for little stones like this just particularly for this little place that I keep grids, and I just make these completely of what feels right, and then I know when it's done. There's a certain point where they're just finished, and I remove it and put another one on. This is the one I have going at the moment, which has nothing to do with what stones I choose for a deck, but so I know that didn't really answer the question as to why. I don't know why. A lot of times it is, to be honest, looks, just in terms of color coordination, but it's not always the case. It depends. And like I said, a lot of times I'll lay something on it and I'll find, I'll keep taking it off and I'll feel like, no, it's not it. Some I'll swap around, not very often. Once they've kind of found it, then I won't so much unless I put it away in its box. And then I don't have stones in the boxes and things. I only keep stones on decks that are sitting out. So that's the answer. Somebody had asked me that, so I thought, oh, I might as well just answer that question. And there we go. So now back to our regularly tuned content. So we now need to answer the question of the day, which is, have you ever regretted a particular reading either for yourself or another? I've never regretted a reading for myself. I have regretted a couple readings. I'm obviously not going to go into any kind of detail because I wouldn't want those to be picked up on. But there have been two, I would say for sure, readings where I knew before I ever even got to the reading that this was not going to go well, that either the person really wasn't interested in a reading or was more interested in, I don't know. I had very a bad feeling about the reading before it ever started, and it didn't go all that well, just in terms, I guess, of reaction to the reading, and it was no surprise to me. And this was, and I, both times, I will say, even before any conversation, just after the initial, you know, request for a reading, before there was anything, I was like, this isn't going to end well. Now, I've gotten better about that feeling, and we'll go to greater depths if that comes up again, which truthfully I haven't had. This was earlier on in reading professionally. I think at this point, like I said, in another reading, most of the time people that are coming to get a reading from me know who I am, and just in terms of they've seen my YouTube videos or follow me on Instagram, or in some ways have an understanding of who I am, how I read, and my personality, my vibes, whatever you want to call it. And so for the most part, I really don't have that problem anymore. It was sort of a early on problem. Again, only happened twice, both times now, but I did get kind of twinges after that, and at every time I made sure to then go and really clarify what the question is, what they expected out of the reading, and what I had to offer. And then very often, every time after those two, usually always came to a really end up having a great reading together once everybody's kind of was situated as to what they were expected versus what they were getting. And one time, I think, after kind of going through that spiel, they opted to decline the reading, which was perfectly fine, you know, because they were looking for something different, which worked wonderfully. So I think it was just getting to the point of knowing when to, you know, be very clear about what was being offered and or what was expected. Because when two people come together to work together, both have some degree of expectations that I think you need to make sure is clear. As time went on, and I have a YouTube channel, and I have an Instagram account, and most of people that come to me have some, follow me on Facebook, follow me on Instagram, or follow me on YouTube. So again, the expectations are already kind of built in from their perspective. They know what they're getting, and that, of course, makes things better. And that is, you know, that happens even, I knew that that could be a problem, so I was very careful to really write everything out in each of my listings. It still is going to happen. Sometimes people don't read the entire thing. You know, sometimes they aren't going to go to your website and look at your sort of, you know, ethical code of ethics, so to speak. You know, sometimes they aren't going to go that extra mile. So then it's on me to make sure that there is a meeting of minds. So in terms of regretting readings, that would be twice that I can think that come to mind. And I don't really regret the readings. I regret that I didn't follow up on my instinct and make sure that things were clarified, because that would have made either a better reading, because at least we would have known what we were coming together to do, and or it would have just allowed for them to go find, you know, somebody that was more in line with what they were looking for. And so in both cases, it would have been either a better experience or not an experience at all. So that is just, I think, kind of comes with learning, you know, just how to deal with things. Oh, I thought Isabel was coughing or choking, but it was a dog, you know, outside in the distance. So that's that. There we go. That's the only two that I can think of. And I was actually happy with the readings. So that was why it's kind of hard, because I was actually happy with the readings, and I felt like the readings were, you know, on target and said what they needed to say. But the reading experience, you know, wasn't really what the person wanted per se. And so the reading experience on both ends wasn't good. So that would be the sense of regretting that I wasn't following that gut feeling and making sure everybody's on the same page. So that's the only things that I can say about that. I hope that answers that question. I always like to peek ahead to see what's coming up. Interesting. So, okay, let's go ahead because I don't even know how long I rambled about decks, showing my decks. I'm actually feeling very, I didn't even say when I got on because I was intent on doing the stones. I feel fantastic today. People have been so wonderful sending great healing vibes and messages. I feel, fantastic. I really do think, to be honest, I don't think I was sick. I think that I was having a flushing out of my system. I had started taking a supplement, and I'm not going to say what it is because I did think about it because I so love this supplement. It's like a natural kind of supplement. I so love it that I do want to share it, but I don't feel comfortable with that because, yeah, I don't want people to say, oh, this is the thing, going out and buying something and maybe not having a great experience with it, you know. So I just thought, nope, I better not open that can of worms. But I started using it in gel form. It's kind of a healing thing. And so I had used it in some on some skin things that I had. I actually had something crop up on my hand, and I saw a video, and I just re-saw it because it popped up something, but I left a comment on it, and I saw that the spots were actually on my hand in that video. I need to find it again because I was like, oh, I wish I would have taken a picture of these because I had two spots show up on my hand right here. Now, there is a little bit of like an agey spot here or a clump of freckles that I've had forever, but right between these knuckles, two spots, one quite large and one smaller underneath it showed up, and they just didn't look right. They just had, I don't know, I just had a bad feeling about them. They didn't look really good. They were funky color and a funky texture, and they kind of popped up out of nowhere, literally. And so I just kind of was like, I don't feel good about that. And my mom has used this supplementy thing, and I know that's being horribly vague. I have to think about it. But anyways, so I had put this on it, and within 3 days they were completely gone. And then I put them, I have a planter's wart of some type, like on my finger. I'm sure everybody's seen it because they've seen my fingers so close. That I've had for a long time and had started getting larger and more irritating. And so it has greatly reduced, and just my nails are horribly needing to be redone. I have to stop and get some nail polish remover. And that's gone way down in just a few days with this gel version. And some other, like I have, you know, as we all do, we have drier spots on our shoulders from getting burnt. Those are going away. So I'm like, was really impressed with this gel. And I was like, I had a sinus thing again. I had a lot, it was actually this side. I had a lot of pain. All my teeth were hurting because my roots are kind of up into my sinus, or my sinus has grown large from lots of sinus infections, whatever happens, where then you can sometimes have your roots of your teeth are so close to your sinus. So when your sinuses that flare up, all of your teeth hurt. It was just not good. And I was like, okay, I knew they had the supplement in liquid form. And I had read great reviews. My mom's used it forever. My mom's big about, you know, supplements. I am too, to a degree. She's really big into like essential oils and things like that. And I am to a degree. It costs quite a lot to get too heavily into that stuff. But I'm really big on using vitamin C and echinacea and tea tree oil and Thieves Oil. Those are the main ones that I go to a lot, but she goes to a lot. So this stuff, she's used for a lot for cuts and burns and things like that. They've used it forever. I'm a research freak, so when I try something new, I like research it to death. And so I'd research it to death, and I thought this liquid stuff could be is really good for you. So I went and picked, but it's a little pricey, so I went and picked it up. And, you know, you would hold it in your mouth for as long as you could, switch, because I, just in case any of the teeth stuff was teeth stuff, which it really is, and it was my sinuses, but swished it around, and then just swallow it. And so I did that twice a day, and what happens is, when you take a supplement like that, that is going to attack, you know, viruses and bacteria and funguses, like it attacks everything, then it has to flush out. And so sometimes when you take a new kind of supplement that's like that, that's going to clean your system out, you can have, it's not a reaction, but it is the toxins kind of being flushed out of your system, and you can get really hot, which I was getting really hot. I kept saying, I'm so hot. So I would get waves of being hot, and then I had waves of needing to go to the restroom, which we will not discuss in detail, but it was that sense. And then I read, you know, I kind of Googled that part, like if it was anybody had reaction, like there's no reaction to this whatsoever, but it can flush toxins out. And that once it was done, you'd feel fantastic. I feel amazing today. So that's what I think it was, is just getting all the crazy bacteria. My face feels amazing. I still have a little bit of stuffiness because I haven't like squirted it up my nose, although you can. I'm just not very fond of that idea. But all of the pressure and the gunk and everything, is totally gone with very quickly. So, cause I took, I think, 2 doses Saturday and then 1 dose Sunday is when I started feeling funky. And then Monday I took 2 doses. So I've done 3 days of the liquid and I now feel amazing. So there we have it. That was the, I don't think I actually had the flu because it said flu-like symptoms, even with this kind of toxic. Maha would know. I should have just messaged Maha. Although it just didn't dawn on me until yesterday that that's what could be what it was. And then, and then today when I felt fantastic, instead of that kind of dragging on of like a flu, kind of getting over flu, it was just bam, I feel amazing. So, but otherwise, I should have, because Maha knows about things like this. I should have messaged her. Anyways, I've been in a good mood. I've done some great readings today, you know, kind of catching up, because I didn't really do anything for 2 days. And so catching up on some readings and had a lesson with a Skype lesson with somebody for Lenormand, plus a chit chat. Yeah, it was kind of a combo chit chat and then have a lesson. So yeah, it's been a good day until I had to try to give Isabella a bath and got soaked from head to toe. So I'm really babbling. We're going to have a card from the Mermaid Oracle or the Oracle of the Mermaids, just because I feel very watery. I just watched Patrick's from In the 78 Cards. He had a video. I don't know that it just went up. I need to catch up on videos. But he had one on rose quartz, which I love. I'm a very quartzy person, and I love it. Right now it's in the middle of my little grid that you saw, one and one's on a deck, the 2 pieces that I have. But I love rose quartz, and it's very, you know, I don't know, it has that watery kind of lovey kind of feel to it. So then I had just watched that when I went to do this, so I was feeling very mermaidy, I guess, because and lovey, because this is kind of a loving and healing, so it felt very much a rose quartz kind of an oracle deck. So that's what we're doing. I feel like a dork. I feel like I'm babbling. So let us move along and see what we get. This is funny because we just got, was it yesterday that we, I don't even remember. We got Coterie. Look what we got. We have sisterhood, friendship, allies, compatible souls, loyalty, joy, and delight. Now, I will say that I think this doesn't just go for women. I think this is because I'm not going to exclude Bart and Mr. Lunar and Patrick, and I don't know if Sputnik sounds like it's a guy's name, but I don't know that that person is a guy. Because I guess when I think Sputnik, I think of like, I don't know what I think about, but I do, probably not a guy. That's terrible. I shouldn't say that. So Mr. or Miss Sputnik, paging Mr. or Miss Sputnik, are you male or female? I love their name, though. Sputnik something else, but that's what always jumps out at me. Anyways, there are some guys who do watch the channel, and I'm not going to exclude them. So I think this is just that idea, again, of camaraderie, of having each other's backs. I like that they are actually all sitting with their backs kind of to each other. Well, one's kind of scooching her head in there to peek out. But there is that, I love that, compatible souls, because that's what we are. We're all compatible souls, or you wouldn't probably be watching my YouTube videos. But it's about joy in it, you know, and really enjoying it, like the little coterie one. I wonder if that's still up here, because I don't think I've shuffled. You know it is. Look. See, we had the little coterie one, which I love, and then we have the sisterhood one. So definitely some multiple message about, you know, finding your, what do they say now? It's all about finding your tribe, you know, finding those people that are your allies, people that are going to have your back, people are going to be supportive and loyal, and a joy and a delight, those people that bring joy to you, you know, that you just smile when you see them, which happens all the time. I love, like, sitting down, which I know I'm a little backed up on because of the last 2 days, but I adore, like, answering messages and, you know, like, YouTube comments, like, responding to comments, even though sometimes I'm bad about emails. Emails are my hard part, just because it starts to build up. But, like, I love that kind of stuff because it brings me joy when I see a comment pop up. When a comment pops up on Instagram, it brings me joy. It makes me happy. Did I put it away? There. You know, the live things where I've really been able to interact more, like chit-chattingness, like, that brings me joy. That sense, I just love it. Plus, I also do have three sisters. No. Yeah, I have three. I had to stop and think. I have 7 siblings, so sometimes I have to stop and think. I have 3 sisters and 3 brothers, and they're quite a lot younger than I am. They are, I was 19 when my youngest sister was born, same parents. I was 18 when the next one, youngest, was born. And then my first sister, I was 12 when she was born. So I was, you know, my youngest sister, I was married. She was still a baby in diapers and not even walking. She was under 1 when I got married. And my other sister was 2 or 2.5 or so when I got married and left the house. So they have felt often more like nieces because of that. Because they were, you know, I would pick them up and, you know, it was really much more like having nieces. So I'm just now, as they're getting older, having that sense of literal sisterhood with my sisters, which I'm quite enjoying, especially my one sister who is 12 years younger than me. She is now, you know, not a little kid anymore because I'm 47. So, you know, and she was an amazing support system during the first, well, she still is, but certainly during that first year, 2 years, that was, you know, so horrible. The first year was so wretched. After Michael died, she was amazingly there for me, for a younger sister. You know, that's kind of, you think of like an older sister being that way, but she was just above and beyond. And so I've learned at a later age what sisterhood means, even though I've had sisters for a long time, which is, kind of sounds weird. But that feeling of somebody having your back, you know, that isn't just in the families we're born with, because some of us aren't born with families that we want to have that connection with. Unfortunately, that's the reality of it. And so it's not always about the blood sisterhood. It's also about the sisterhoods, the coteries, I love that word, that we form. And so just be aware that the people that we hold close to us should be filling us with joy when we think of them. Should be, and not always, sometimes you're going to have disagreement, but there should be loyalty there. There should be delight in the relationship. I love these keywords. We should be compatible souls. If they're not, you might want to think about why you're having them in your bubble space too much, because then it starts to work in a negative fashion. So there we go. We need to be surrounding ourselves with compatible souls. It doesn't mean that we all have to agree. It doesn't mean that we all have to believe the same thing, but we should be compatible, respectful, learning from each other, all these marvelous things that comes from forming our sisterhoods and brotherhoods for all of you men out there. So there we go. I'm going to end because this is ridiculously long and babbly, and I'm going to have to figure out how to edit some of that health supplement talk out without it being so horribly choppy. So you all have an absolutely wonderful day, and I will talk to you tomorrow because we are still in, but we're in the home stretch of the end of January. I did a little bit work on in bulk, so because I want to do a video on that for in bulk, but yeah, we are starting to wrap up January. It's starting to feel like it's coming quickly. So I will see you all tomorrow. Okay, I know this light is like right over the top of my head, but I have to share a song with you that is making me so excited and happy every time I hear it. So I'm going to share it with you. I can't play very much of it because there is cussing in it. If you are not opposed to a slight bit of cussing for a wonderful toe tapping dance experience, then I will put a link to it in the discussion or the description box below. But let's just hear a little bit of it because I haven't done it again. Speakers up loud and tell me if you don't dance. Okay, I'm gonna turn it off.
Please just tie me down. Somebody give me a goddamn drink.